Hi guys, this is Dr. Piracha again, and this is the second video that I'm doing on a clinical vignette. And this is for students who are going to be taking USMLE Step 2 CK primarily. And I've devised a system where you can look through the question methodically and get to the right answer as quickly as possible. I call it the peak learning system. I've already done one video presentation on it, and I've divided the clinical stem into three parts: helpers, guiders, and clinchers. We already talked about helpers, so today we're gonna talk about guiders. And all I need is 10 minutes of your time, and I promise you it's gonna be over in 10 minutes. And if you pay attention to the points that I'm gonna be making, it's gonna make it so easy for you to approach these questions in the most efficient manner. So without wasting any further time, we're gonna get started. The first slide is the peak learning system that I've devised. The second slide is basically just an introduction about me. And the third slide, this is how a peak learner approaches the stem of a clinical vignette. I've divided the stem into three parts: helpers, guiders, and clinchers. We already talked about helpers in our previous video. We're gonna do a brief overview of helpers in this video too, but this video is primarily about the guiders. So without wasting any time, let's do the next slide. So the first thing that we have to answer is, what exactly is a guider in a clinical vignette type question? So a guider is actually the symptoms and signs they give you in the clinical stem. So let's go through it with an example. So we have a 70-year-old obese African-American male with a past medical history of hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, who has been smoking one pack per day for 40 years, and he's presenting to the emergency department. Now, this is exactly the same presentation that I did in my previous video when I talked about the helpers, but just a refresher. All these points that I've mentioned, starting with 70-year-old, obese, African-American, male, history of hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, who's been smoking one pack per day for 40 years, all of these clues from 1 to 8, I call them the helpers. They help you get to the right answer, but you cannot just get the right answer just with the helpers. You need more assistance. So let's talk about guiders. So the question continues: patient has sudden onset of substernal chest pain while he was sipping his coffee sitting on his couch. So pay attention. Number 9 and number 10. Now we're talking about guiders. Substernal chest pain is typical for acute coronary pain. Acute coronary pain is usually located substernally. So this hint is already guiding you. The second one is pain at rest. This is typical for acute coronary pain, including acute coronary syndromes, but it's not typical for stable angina. So we'll talk about stable angina in a future lecture in more detail. But what I'm trying to say is, number 9 and number 10 are guiders because they are helping you. These are symptoms. Let's go to the next slide. So there are some more hints over here, and this is still the symptoms, and these are still the guiders. Pain is pressure type, squeezing, and associated with diaphoresis, nausea, and feeling of doom. So what's the quality of the pain? I talk about pain is pressure type, squeezing, like an elephant sitting on my chest. A lot of patients describe it that way. This is the classic pain of acute coronary syndrome. Associated symptoms: diaphoresis, nausea, and feeling of doom are commonly associated with acute coronary pain. So I gave you all this data and I said these are all the guiders. What is the peak learner point? Symptoms are one component of guiders. At this point, when you get to this point in the clinical stem where you've got all your helpers and some of your guiders, you should start connecting the guiders to helpers in your mind, and the picture will continue to get clearer. Okay, The second component of guiders is the physical examination. I talk about the signs. So let's see the same patient that we are following. His physical exam is remarkable for ashen skin color, moist, clammy extremities, and a blood pressure of 87 over 51. He's got a positive JVD and he's got tender hepatomegaly. I describe intentionally all these signs that I'm describing, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20, are characteristic of patients who are having an acute ST elevation myocardial infarction. Systemic hypotension is very common in myocardial infarctions involving a large part of myocardium. Why does the patient have moist, clammy extremities? He's hypoperfusing due to his cardiac output that has decreased, and also because of increased peripheral vascular resistance, which causes a reduction in blood flow in the extremities to support more vital organs. Also, JVD and tender hepatomegaly are very common with right coronary artery occlusion causing right ventricular infarction. So I give you all the symptoms that are commonly associated with acute coronary syndrome. Now I give you all the signs that are associated with ST elevation myocardial infarction involving the right coronary artery and the right ventricle. What will happen? When the right ventricle gets infarcted, it causes increased pressure in the right atrium, and both your superior and inferior vena cava are actually draining into the right atrium. As the pressure in right atrium is going to build up, the back pressure is going to be transmitted to all the peripheral areas from where the superior inferior vena cava are draining, and the inferior vena cava is draining blood from the liver. So you will get hepatomegaly because of that, and the JVD will be because of back pressure that's increased in the superior vena cava. So what's the peak learner point? The peak learner point is symptoms are guiders, signs are also guiders. Connect the guiders to helpers in your mind, and the picture keeps getting clearer and clearer. So what's the take-home point in the last couple of minutes? By the time you complete the guiders in the clinical stem, picture should be pretty clear in your mind. Remember, helpers, they have good ruling out power, or in other words, they are highly sensitive. So if I give you a patient who is obese, who's got hypertension, diabetes, all the risk factors, then you can be pretty sure that if he's having an acute myocardial infarction, it's very much likely in the setting of all those risk factors. All the helpers are highly sensitive. They help you rule out the diagnosis. In other words, if I give you a young patient who has no risk factors, then you can rule out that he's not having an acute myocardial infarction with the help of the helpers. The problem is the helpers are poor in ruling in. They have poor ruling in power. They have poor specificity. How do I explain it? Remember, if a patient has all the risk factors, hypertension, diabetes, obesity, but he could also be having a pneumonia. You cannot just say that he has all those risk factors and it is acute coronary syndrome because it could be pneumonia. People with risk factors can have a lot of different diagnoses. Helpers have a poor specificity. They have a poor ruling in power. They cannot help you much in ruling the diagnosis in. That's where your guiders come in. They are better. They have a better ruling out power. They have better sensitivity. If you have a patient who doesn't have any risk factors and who doesn't have clinical symptom or exam findings consistent with acute coronary syndrome, you can rule it out. But at this stage, when you are at the guiders, they have a good ruling in power too. If your guiders are telling you the patient has signs and symptoms associated with acute coronary syndrome, you can be very more confident that you can rule it in. So things are keep getting better as we move from helpers to guiders. They have better specificity. So hang on, and in the next lecture, we're going to talk about clinchers. Your feedback is very important. Please give me your feedback, and I promised I was going to finish it in 10 minutes, and here we are. Thanks so much.